Queen Anne came to the throne in 1702. In the 12 years that she reigned, she became the last monarch to veto a Bill of Parliament. She oversaw the union of Scotland and England. Gibraltar became a colony. Marlborough won the Battle of Blenheim, which is why we now have Blenheim Palace. The Spectator magazine was started. Handel came to live in England. And the last execution for witchcraft took place. Anne was the last of the Stuart monarchs. She was the daughter of James II and the sister of the previous queen, Mary. She married Prince George of Denmark, who was treated with contempt by King William. They had no surviving child, although she had been pregnant 18 times. She has been described as unhealthy, dull-witted, and, like her father, a bigot. Although Anne was a Protestant, whereas James, of course, was a Roman Catholic. Her connection with and affection for John Churchill, whom she made Duke of Marlborough, developed while she was still Princess Anne. Marlborough's wife, Sarah Churchill, was her lady of the bedchamber, her closest confidant. She, like her sister, was quite disloyal towards their father. During the 1688 revolution, Anne had joined the rebellion at Nottingham. But close to the throne were some of the most able people of the new century.
The age of Anne is rightly regarded as the greatest manifestation of the power of England which had till then been known. Sarah Churchill managed the Queen, Marlborough managed the war, and Godolphin managed the Parliament.
This was Sidney Godolphin, who had served Charles II and James II, and who was, for the first 5 years at least, Anne's closest political adviser.
There was at that time an extraordinary wealth of capacity in the English governing class. It was also the Augustan age of English letters. Addison, Defoe, Pope, Steele, Swift. There was a vehement outpouring of books, poems and pamphlets. Art and science flourished. The work of the Royal Society, founded in Charles II's reign, now bore a largesse of fruit. Sir Isaac Newton, in mathematics, physics and astronomy, completed the revolution of ideas which had begun with the Renaissance. Architecture was led to noble achievements by Wren and to massive monuments by Vanbrugh.
We tend to think of Wren as a 17th century figure with the rebuilding of the City of London after the Great Fire, but he was a prodigious worker, very much a favourite of the court, and he didn't die until 1723.
The beginning of Queen Anne's reign seemed to open a period of Tory prosperity. All King William's Whig ministers were banished from power. But from the very outset, a deep division opened between Marlborough, to whom Godolphin was inseparably bound, and their Tory colleagues. The traditional Tory view was that England should not aspire to play a leading part in the continental struggle.
Churchill's talking here about the War of Spanish Succession, which England was partly responsible for starting.
Her true policy was to intervene only by sea power, and amid the conflicts of Europe, to gain many territories overseas in the outer world. The Tories regarded with aversion the sending of large armies to the continent. They looked with disparaging eyes upon victories in Europe. They groaned, or affected to groan, under the burden of army expenses. They alleged that the interests which urged active intervention made great profits out of the war by subscribing to government loans. The Whigs, on the other hand, though banished from office, were ardent advocates of the greatest military efforts. They supported Marlborough. This clash of opinion governed the politics of the reign. There was a religious complication. Queen Anne, Marlborough and Godolphin were all Tories, born and bred, and all were Anglicans. Anne had long ago abandoned the conviction that her father's son, the exiled Prince of Wales, was not her brother.
At the time of his birth, there was a rumour that the prince wasn't actually the son of James and his wife Mary of Medina, that he had been smuggled into the palace in a warming pan simply as a ploy to guarantee the Catholic succession to the throne. Anne no longer believed this story, if ever she had. But having lived through one rebellion, indeed having taken part in it at her own father's expense, it would not have been at all inconceivable to Anne that there might be another rebellion in England.
The prince lived under French protection. He is known to British history as the Old Pretender, but more gallantly in French annals as the Chevalier of St. George. Queen Anne felt herself in her most inner conscience a usurper, and she was also gnawed by the feeling that she had treated her dead father ill. Her one justification against these self-questionings was her absolute faith in the Church of England. It was her duty to guard and cherish at all costs this sacred institution, the maintenance of which was bound up with her own title and the peace of her realm.
But of more immediate concern was the effort needed for the war in Europe. In 1702, Louis believed that the death of King William, his one-time enemy, had weakened the English resolve to join the Grand Alliance against him.
He counted upon a period of hesitation and loss of contact, which, if turned to good account by military action, might break the Dutch and scare off the English. He regarded Marlborough as a favoured court personage, able, no doubt, and busy with intrigue, but owing his influence entirely to the Queen's affection for his wife. The French High Command, therefore, did not hesitate to place their main army, as soon as the campaign season began, within 20 miles of Nimwegen. In May, Marlborough made for Nimwegen. He found widespread despondency among Allied troops and jealousy among the generals. But when his hand was felt upon the army and its operations, a different mood prevailed. In a brilliant campaign, the new captain-general conquered all the fortresses of the Meuse, and thus the whole river channel was freed. When Marlborough returned to The Hague, he was received with intense public joy by the Dutch, and on his arrival in England, he was created Duke by the Queen. In his very first year, the tide of the war was set flowing in the opposite direction, and the whole alliance, which had seemed about to collapse, was knit together by new bonds of constancy and hope.
Marlborough is commanding the alliance of the Dutch Republic, the Holy Roman Empire, and the British. Later, the Portuguese and the Germans will join the alliance. Actually, German states would be a better description. There wasn't a Germany as we know it today. They are all fighting the French. It's the War of the Spanish Succession, an attempt to stop the power balance in Europe, swinging either to Louis XIV of France or to Emperor Leopold of Austria. But England also fought against the French because Louis might have invaded England, given the opportunity, in support of the Catholic Jacobite claim to the throne. So it's 1703, incidentally the year Samuel Pepys died, and in spite of initial success, the alliance is losing ground to the French.
Both at home and abroad, the fortunes of the Grand Allies sank to a low ebb in the winter of 1703. Marlborough, during the winter months, planned the supreme stroke of strategy which turned the whole fortune of the war. But before he could proceed to the continent, it was essential to reconstitute the government of the High Tories. Rochester was already dismissed, and Nottingham was soon to go. A new figure was required to fill the void. Robert Harley, so active in reducing the armed forces and opposing King William's foreign policy, had been Speaker, leader of the moderate Tories, and virtually leader of the House of Commons. He was now invited to become Secretary of State, and the inner circle of the government was widened to admit him. The combination became Marlborough, Godolphin, and Harley, with the Queen and Sarah as before.
This is Sarah Churchill, Marlborough's wife.
In Harley's train, Henry St. John, a young member who had made himself conspicuous by his brilliant speeches and was in high favour with the Tories, became Secretary at War, a post which brought him into close contact with Marlborough. All this being arranged, and a parliamentary majority composed of the moderate Tories and the Whigs being procured, the Duke sailed for Holland.
Or, as they were then known, the United Provinces. This journey was the start of one of the most famous land battles in English history. French and Spanish forces advanced on Vienna. The English and Dutch armies were on the defensive in the Netherlands. Many of the alliance leaders grumbled that Austria was too far away for them to worry about. Marlborough didn't think so. He saw the survival of Austria as essential to the alliance, and its fall as the main ambition of the French. Marlborough began...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.